Good morning, Blessed.
Good morning. Good morning.
Okay? Different, huh? How come, Pastor, this morning I read you differently? You are the Blessed because God bless you. God sent Jesus Christ come to this world to bless you. And before I go into the sermon, I am reminded by Sister Siu Chu to thank you all for praying for her. Let us welcome her back. God is good and God is great.
Amen.
And God answered prayer. Today she is so happy that because she has recovered and able to join us. And the first thing that she wanted to do was to worship God.
Amen.
Now, before I begin the sermon, I would like to show you the undeniable truth for life. You are what you eat, and you are what you read. Recently, I went for the medical checkup. I did not tell you the result, right? The result of my medical checkup is this. The doctor told me that I am overweight by 5 kg. And I'm high in bad cholesterol. Good cholesterol was very good, but the bad cholesterol is climbing. So, I'm told that I should go on medication. So, the doctor say I must eat healthy food. And I must do regular exercise. To avoid having stroke or heart attack. So when the doctor said this, I say, there goes my lasa. And the doctor say, okay, never mind, you eat the noodle but don't drink the gravy. Cut it down to maybe once or twice a week. Then the doctor warned me, hey, Christmas is coming. Right? Christmas is coming. Be careful what you eat, because the doctor know that I'm working in the church, that we have Christmas celebration and things like that. Then I said, there goes my locket. So the doctor looked at me with much sympathy and say, okay, never mind. You eat the lock, but don't eat the cake. So you know what is my New Year resolution. Because what I do with my life is critical. I cannot blame my poor health if I do not make wise choices in the things I can eat and have the discipline to maintain it. I'm not sure about your New Year resolution. You want to be more relaxed, you want to be do less work, less anxiety, you want to be more happy in your life. I'm sure all of us have something in mind that because we know that we want to live a good life. But we must know the source of life and what to do and what to take in. So therefore, you see, the physical life is so much linked to what we eat. So in the same manner, we can be spiritually unhealthy if we do not receive spiritual nutrients from the right source. So I want to ask you this morning, how is your physical food? And how is your spiritual food? We want to consider this morning from the wisdom book, the book of Psalm, the very first Psalm, The psalm begins with Psalm number 1, telling us that the very word of the Holy God must be the source of our spiritual health. And also, the Holy Word of God will also be the source that will assure of our eternal destiny. And you know, if you look at the book of Psalms, there are 150 Psalms. So, after the first Psalm, the other 149 Psalms illuminate the greatness of our God, affirm His faithfulness to us in times of trouble, and remind us of the absolute centrality of His Word. And then the whole book of Psalms, if you were to flip to Psalm number 150, and you will notice Psalm 150 happened to be also 6 verses, just like the Psalm number 1. And you go to the last verse of Psalm 150, you see that the Psalm means declares everything that has breath, praise the Lord. In other words, Psalm number 1 sums up the whole book in declaring that God is the source that leads to certainty in our serviceability in His kingdom and surety in our salvation. So the blessed will praise God at the end of our life and in eternity. So first let us look at verse 1 and 2, the source of counsel. Some may say, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffer, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. Now the word blessed here in Hebrew, Old Testament is written in Hebrew, is plural. In other words, he's talking about in many blessings. We are blessed in many, there are many blessings and in many ways. The man here refer to any man or any woman or any person that is from any background, any cultural background, any race on earth, no matter who you are, from any political or any economical background. That means any human being who live a life that has God as his source of spiritual nutrients will be blessed in many ways. His or her life is marked by rejecting the counsel or the opinion of the wicked. The wicked here refer to godless people, people who reject God, people who say that there is no God. Where they come from, he will give you a theory, either scientific theory or something that is bizarre. We just come by accident. The blessed will not walk or follow what they advocate, in other words. The blessed will reject the practice. Here he says, they will not stand in the same way of the wicked. The blessed will refuse to sit in the seat of the scoffer. In other words, the blessed will not be associated with those who scoff or scorn at God. I am sure you have encountered this, that there are people, in fact many, not only reject the gospel if we try to share with them, but they will even say something bad about Christianity, bad about Christianity. Sometimes it's true, but most of the time not lecturing. How is it possible? How is it possible that the blessed man, the blessed woman, that is able to do this, that is to reject the wicked, wicked way, wicked opinion, and the way that they live their life. Psalmist tells us that because he delights in the law of God, and he will meditate on the law of God day and night. That's what Deacon Ronald prayed just now from Joshua chapter 1 verse 8. Joshua became very successful not because he is brilliant, but because in the very first chapter of Joshua, there you see that God told him a success formula. So the blessed love, delight means to love, to have the word of God read, studied, and applied in all aspects of their life. This is what it means when the psalmist talk about the blessed delight in the law of God and meditate on it day and night. And in all situations, at all times, at all places. That is what it means to delight in God's law. In other words, there is a change of heart. A heart drawn to God. The holy nature of God takes over, listen carefully, because of the word of God, the holy nature of God takes over the whole being of the blessed. As a result, he will feel the discomfort in seeing sins and evils. He will naturally reject the conduct of the godless people. God's truth transforms his thinking. God's truth transforms his values, and he turns from idols to serve the true and living God. Sound familiar to you? From 1 Thessalonians, right? The picture that you see on the screen, I shared during the watch night service, that it really moved my heart. Here we see the evil, injustice, and cruelty as a result of the sinful man and sinful conduct. The refugees in Europe, look at the children on the bottom left photograph as they try to break through the police cordon in Greece. And look at the fear on their face and the hopelessness that they face in the future. And the man who sits on the floor is a retired pensioner. But people all queue up to the bank to withdraw all their pension. He faced with hopelessness, penniless, and with people homeless and even stateless. And on the right bottom corner, we see the refugee trying to get into Myanmar for almost 2 months, floating, drifting on the sea. In the sea, and when the rain comes, and he tried to catch the raindrop to quench their thirst. This is the real world out there, my dear brothers and sisters. Surely, for the blessed, when we look at all these things, especially in such a sheltered, protected Singaporean, we ought to know, and our heart ought to be moved. And cry out, O Lord, come quickly. Come quickly to rescue us. This is where we see in the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation chapter 22. Let me read to you verse 16 and 17. to explain to you what I'm talking about. After hearing all the revelation that Jesus Christ revealed to Apostle John, this is how the revelation come to an end. I, Jesus, no one else but Jesus, very clear, He is the one. So actually the book of Revelation should be the revelation of Jesus Christ to His Apostle Paul, Apostle John. Have sent my angel to testify to you about this thing for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. And let the one who is thirsty, come. And let the one who desires take the water of life without price. What I'm saying to you is that if we are the blessed, that we have the holy word of God, or the word of the holy God. And when we see all this thing that's happening, we will definitely cry out, O Lord, come and rescue the innocent children. Come and rescue us from this sinful world. And come and rescue us from this sinful body. God's word changed the blessed inner self completely. God's words make the blessed capable of honoring Him even when it means answering call to rigorous and even radical change to their life. When we delight in the word of God, our life change. So the application for us is this. Let us learn to delight in God's words. If we have not come to this point of being able to, as I described, delight in the Word of God, we will not feel anything at all about the sins in this world, injustices in this world, and even the sin in ourselves. Therefore, our life will never make any change. So, in application, we should seek deepening faith. We want to go deeper into the Word so that we can experience deepening faith. So we should draw close to God in His Word to revitalize, to refresh our soul. Be humble before the Almighty God. How many times that you have really humbled yourself before God when you open the Bible? Are you approaching the Word with humbleness, humility, that Lord, teach me, change me. You see, humility is the prerequisite for faith and life. You cannot be converted to Christianity if you are not humble. If you do not, recognize your sins and your hopelessness. The delight in God's law or God's word will make the blessed serviceable to God. That is what the psalmist says in verse 3 and 4. The blessed is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. My dear brothers and sisters, you see the psalmist say the blessed is like a tree, just like this one. A tree that planted by many streams. I want to draw you to this attention. The psalmist say planted by many streams. Not one, but many. In other words, in many ways, as I said just now, blessed in plural. In many ways, God will bless the blessed. God, through His Son Jesus Christ, has provided us, or provided the blessed, grace, love, joy, peace, And all this can be found in the Word of God. And also in the fellowship, in the worship, and in the prayer ministry of the church. And the psalmist say, in due season, the blessed will produce fruit. That is, according to God's timing, the blessed will become fruitful. Not overnight, but a process of an enriching journey. The tree is kept strong, fresh, and lively. In other words, evergreen. Because the leaf, according to the psalmist, the leaf does not wither. It will not dry up. It will not die. It will not drop off. You see the picture? And he says, all that he does, he prospers. Therefore, the blessed's life is influential. That is what it means. It is impactful in all aspects of his life and in all seasons, from young to the old age. So we get a picture of the evergreen leaf, which is also the image of being transformed and transforming others. A natural process of overflowing serviceability to the Lord. We never see a tree that act up, isn't it? The tree that planted next to the stream. In this case, many streams. Even one of the stream is dried up. There are still other streams to nourish the tree. When the tree will just grow and with all the fertilizers and the nutrients, it will just bear fruits. Have you ever seen a tree pretend to bear fruits or force itself to bear fruits? No. So this is the description of the blessed. This is supposed to be the life of a Christian who have Jesus Christ in their life. A service that is not forced, but naturally flow out of their life as they keep themselves connected to the many streams of God. The blessed long for soul prosperity more than anything else. In contrast, the psalmist says, the godless, the wicked, are like chaff. They mean dirt. That means dead, worthless, without substance, and easily carried or blown away by the wind. In other words, the wicked become unserviceable to God. Unserviceable, unable to serve God due to sin against God. So the wicked will see that all achievement on earth without God is chaff. Because death will end everything they achieve in life. Let me give you an illustration of these two kinds of life. There are two seas here on the screen. First is the Sea of Galilee on the north, and then the Dead Sea. The Sea of Galilee has many fish and is overflowing life in it. And it feeds all the land around the sea. The Dead Sea, on the other hand, has no outlet. It's lacking of life in itself. That is why it's called a Dead Sea. The blessed will have a life like the Sea of Galilee. You know, when you go there, you will definitely hear about this. And die, you must try it. Called St. Peter fish. And it is from the Sea of Galilee. Of course, that fish doesn't belong to St. Peter. But it is a taste of the fish that it had its life and grown in the Sea of Galilee. So I was there once, and have the opportunity to taste the flesh of St. Peter fish firsthand and be reminded of a life like this Sea of Galilee should be the life of all Christians. So which is yours? Sea of Galilee or the Dead Sea? Let me ask you, my dear brothers and sisters, do you feel alive? Do you feel useful to people and God this morning? A life that's producing life? Or are you feeling dry? Are you feeling the dryness? Are you feeling uselessness? Or are you feeling that the same old thing is taking control of your life and threatening to make your life exactly the same in 2016? If you want to live a life that will leave behind a legacy of fruitful service, then apply this. Keep the freshness of your life and faith. It is no more having a life and then have a faith in Jesus Christ, but it is dry. It is dry and it has no impact on other people, to influence other people. Plan your life by many streams. For example, good read. Read good books. Good eat. This one I must take note. Eat good food that will lead to good health. Good exercise. Widen your experience with God and people. So that your life, your imaginations will be fired up. Watch good movie. Seek breakthrough. Don't maintain status quo. Break new grounds by looking beyond what you are doing now or maybe in the past many years. Look for greater serviceability in Christ's kingdom. Do good, do new ministry, meet new people. Worship Him, sing more new songs. Visit new places to experience afresh God's blessing for a stronger finish in this life. Get out of your comfort zone. You see, when you are really delighting in God's law and living like a tree planted by many streams of water, your journey on earth will be sweet and your eternal destiny will be very sure. That is, you will stand in God's presence celebrating victory when the evil of the godless will not trouble you anymore. This is what the psalmist say in the last two verses in Psalm number 1. The surety of salvation. This is where the life will end. Therefore, he said, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregations of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Psalmist tells us that the wicked will suffer double doom. Look at verse number 5. He said they will not be able to stand and defend for themselves on judgment day. They will not be acquitted. And therefore fear will come upon them. Next blow is that they will not be found in the company of the blessed. They are not regenerated. That is, they are unrenewed. Not changed by the grace of Jesus Christ to live in heaven, which is the pure and sinless environment. You see, there may be a mix of the renewed and the unrenewed soul in the church on earth. just like the sheep and the goats that mix together and graze on the same place, but not in heaven. The wicked will live a life without God and perish without God. Verse 6 says that the way of the wicked will perish. That means the arrogance of the wicked who rejected God, who live by their own idols, their ways of pleasure, their way of pride, their way of unbelief, their way of persecuting the righteous, the way of self-deception, all these will come to an end. The psalmist says, the wicked shall cease to trouble other people. On the other hand, the blessed have God as their source of life, enjoying sweet encouragement. Why? Because the psalmist says, the Lord knows the way of the righteous. What does it mean? It means that God has the knowledge of the situation in the outer and the inner life of the blessed. God knows every of their practice of faith in good and the bad times. And God will provide support. God will deliver them. God will grant them wisdom and strength to overcome and lead them finally to glory. This is what it means. The blessed know that God knows everything they are going through. I'm sure every one of us have fear today. I'm sure every one of us here have certain concern. Maybe health, maybe finance, maybe education, maybe relationship, maybe your work project, school project, whatever. I assure you, based on the word of God here, God knows. God knows everything. Sometimes even we try to deny ourselves. God knows everything. So my dear brothers and sisters, God knows exactly what we are going through, and He will help and He will heal if we will go to Him. Because of the nutrients the blessed receive from the Word of God, the spiritual nutrients, they are made strong and have the confidence of the life ahead of them. So this is the application for us. Pay attention. Come together. Come together and encourage one another. For what? To look beyond the problems that each of us are facing and look to Jesus and follow His way. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 9 to 11, we studied before. It says, for God has not destined us for wrath, anger or punishment again, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us so that what? Whether we are awake or asleep, that means we are alive or we are dead, we might live with Him. It is assured. My dear brothers and sisters, we believe in Jesus Christ. We have life eternal. We will not die. Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing. I thank God for TCPC, as I shared in the Watch Night service, especially the last few months of 2015, I see God caused me to see a strong finishing, ending of the year in this church here. The rise of brethren in the church to really show love and care for one another. And therefore, I testify that surely God wants to build on this foundation and continue to build up one another in 2016. So in conclusion, the blessed as Christ as the power source for life, for service, and for salvation. In our responsive reading this morning from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18 to 31, I want to point to you, verse 24. He says, but to those who are called, referring to the blessed, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God,
wisdom of God.
In other words, Christ will be the one who gives us the strength and teach us how to live our life. And verse 30, and because of Him you are in Christ Jesus, the blessed are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification and redemption. You see, when Christ saved us, He never just saved us. He continued to work in our life, and He wants to work in our life to sanctify us. That means is to change us, to transform us, to renew us, so that we can be ready for the day of redemption. The wicked use their own resources to their own destruction, as the psalmist indicated. Christians are given the power to live, not to die anymore. Christians' life is about a life in, a life with, and a life for Christ. Christians' life is not about dying, but know how to live like Christ. Believe in what Christ had provided and live each day with His power. That is what we should do. Do not take it lightly, the power of what you read, just like the power of what you eat. So the truth for life: the blessed will draw from Jesus Christ, which is the fountain, which is the fountainhead of all wisdom and strength for life eternal. Jesus will be able to lift us up above all the troubles in this world and use us to influence people in the world. So, only in Jesus Christ can we have a life well lived in this world. So life is short and fleeting. The days are full of evil. The road ahead may be rough and tough, and along the way we may suffer illnesses. We may continue to see all kinds of suffering in the world around us. We may suffer setback in life, but we will be fine if we draw from Jesus, who loved us and died for us. Let me share a bit of my experience. Currently, I'm experiencing the emptiness. My children are all grown up, and they have their own life. I learned two very important lessons here to share with you. Number one, the importance of teaching our children the Word of God when they are young. I have a mixed feeling in this emptiness is because, firstly, I find that my house has got more space because I have four children, you know, and totally altogether six of us. So when they leave, there are more space for me to move about freely. But that is still not the most important thing. The next thing is that I feel the sense of accomplishing or finishing my duty and responsibility as parent. Now is the time to let them go. You know what the Chinese saying, you know, 责任完了就是 人生最快乐的一件事，对吗？ 徐祖姐? Because you sit back and you see, wow, I have done my best to give the Word of God to my children. Lord, take over. Take them and make them. Right. So that is a sense of relief. And now I sit back and see how they will walk with God and live their life. And second thing is that it reminds me, because of the emotional vacuum, inevitable, because we are so close as a family, as parents and children, it reminds me very powerfully that all of us must put Christ first and be very, very close to Him, because only Christ can fill the vacuum, can fill the emptiness, can fill our emotional vacuum. to walk closely with God. Do not allow things and even people to be the first place in your life. Because at the end of the day, we depend on Christ to bring us to the end of our journey in eternity. So, blessed, we must teach ourselves and we must teach one another with the Word of God about Jesus Christ and His finished work of salvation on the cross for all of us. Therefore, I would like you to refer to the bulletin, and you will see the first page of the bulletin have changed. It is a new one because it's a new year. The vision of TCEPC is to draw from Jesus Christ because He is the one building the church. He is the one who gave His life to establish the church, not me or anyone else. Christ and His gospel is to be the center in all things pertaining to church ministry, not men, not buildings. Our mission, as you see here, is to faithfully doing the four ministry, the ministry of the word, the fellowship, the worship, and the prayer. As we do this faithfully, we make disciple making disciple, and begin to lose our selfish life, to live a sacrificial life. Selfish life is our old life. Sacrificial life is the true life that Jesus Christ wants us to live. And this is in Jesus what the Psalm number 1 is about. So, final conclusion and application. Do something new in 2016. Resolution for TCEPC. First, meet God every day. Slow down. Okay? Slow down. Don't be a Russian. Okay? Slow down. Find a place, find a time, whether morning, afternoon, or evening, and use a way to be still before God. Still before God. Keep still before God long enough to allow relaxation and inner change to take place in your life. Okay? Talk to God about your life struggle. He wants to know. And ask Him to help and heal you. Until the delight of God dawn upon you, then you live. Let this experience of the conversion of your heart to be the new normal for TCEPC. Number 2, meet someone on weekdays. We are so busy, we have really have no time, I understand that. But you have to make time. Find people you are comfortable with. People you can confide your sins, and people who can sincerely point out your shortcomings and pray for you. I'm encouraged by the adult group. They are going to start a weekday intentional discipleship group this month. Eric Rohia? Chet Pinia? I'm so happy to hear that they are going to start a weekday meeting. They are going to meet together, not just the young people. Share your life experience, but listen carefully. Make sure you share your life experience in relation to Jesus Christ. Okay? Not just eating and drinking without mentioning Jesus Christ. Then it becomes social gathering, which you don't have to come to this church to find. Make your life count for Jesus. Meet to change your life and change the life of others. I repeat. The goal of your meeting is to change life. Change your life and change others. Be humble. Never do anything to impress others. Never pray because you have to, but you want to. Consciously and submit to the authority of the Holy Spirit and make improvement to the quality of life and the quality of your service. Do not quench the Holy Spirit I want you. Whenever the Spirit prompts you to do something good for others, do it. Set your hearts to live for others out of your love for Jesus Christ. The Word of God will remind you. So wherever you go, whatever you do, look for such an opportunity. Seek to make others win, like this footballer. I was reading the paper. It was reported that this particular professional football player in the EPL, he loved to assist other people to score. So when the ball come to him in the penalty box, he will look for somebody who is in the better position to score, and then he passed the ball to him, and then he scored. Professional football player, you should put in more goals so that your market value will go up. But it did not happen. And this is what he wants to do. We must have this mindset of going to a meeting to meet people and to make people win. Help people to win. You can change this mindset. And you'll find that your life will be totally transformed. And you'll find that the people's life will also be transformed. So if you meet God every day and you meet someone on weekdays, your Sunday will be a completely different experience when you meet everyone in church. The one you meet on weekdays is likely to follow you to church. And you will see the church multiply right before your eyes. You will see your life in church just flow out of the meeting you have with God every day and with people on weekdays. So dear brothers and sisters, in Christ we have new beginning. If we commit to honor God, He will honor us. In time to come, we will see in TCEPC a people who rely only on Christ and always put Him at the center of everything they do or say, ensure that He is glorified. So whoever visit this church in future will say the same thing, and they want to be part of it. Let me assure you. The book of Acts tells us that when the believers devote their time in the Word, in fellowship, in worship and prayer, miracles happen in the church. And they meet in the church and they meet at home, and God brings more and more people come to believe in Christ and join the church. Look at this. Let me read to you. Because this is captured in our mission statement. And they devoted themselves to the apostle teaching and the fellowship and the breaking of bread as worship and the prayer. And all, listen carefully, and all came upon every soul. Every. And many wonders and signs were being done through who? Through the apostle. And all who believed were together, not like speaking sense, together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possession and belonging and distributing it, the proceeds to all. To all. As any had need. There is no lack at all. Verse 46, and day by day, attending the temple, that means going to the church, together and breaking bread in their homes. So it is not just the church, but also homes are also involved. Thank God for TCEPC. They received their food with glad and generous heart. You see, the transformed life is going on here. Praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to them, to their number day by day, those who were being saved. May God help us. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this new year. As we think of the prospect of going back to work tomorrow, going to school tomorrow, going to deal with our problems tomorrow, Lord, we must confess that we are lost. we are afraid. We fear. We fear for our future. But we thank you, Lord, because we have Jesus. We have your Holy Word. And we desperately need the nutrition that, Lord, your Word can supply. We thank you for the Word this morning. And we pray, dear Lord, that we will do something. We will not go back to the same old thing. But something, Lord, help us. That something new will happen to us. That we will have the strength and the courage and to take the step of faith to do something good for ourselves, for our family, for our community, for our society, and for the kingdom of God. Dear Lord, this church, under the leadership of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, will continue to prosper. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
A young and promising man, he was directed by his father to study law and to be a lawyer.